Chicago in the 1920s was a place for reform and free expression. The flapper redefined the modern woman, jazz music blossomed, and there were numerous new technologic advances. The Roaring Twenties was marked by a break in old traditions. The city was known for its hard drinkers, its sexual promiscuity, and new wealth. As a result, Chicago flourished with crime.
Two young, wealthy Jewish boys, Nathan Leopold and Richard Loeb, called the city their home. Born the son of a retired Sears Roebuck vice president, Richard A. Loeb was the youngest person to graduate from the University of Michigan. As a boy, he was infatuated with detective stories. He planned and committed many crimes throughout his teenage years, but none involved physical harm. To him, it was a game, and he became obsessed with committing the perfect crime. Nathan F. Leopold Jr., Richard's lover, was the son of a billionaire box manufacturer. He was a law student at the University of Chicago, but was soon to begin studies at Harvard. He had a passion for ornithology, the study of birds. His favorite pastime was bird watching. The wealthy young boyhood friends formed a sexual relationship. For Loeb, the thought of crime was an escape from the ordinary, an interesting intellectual exercise. However, Leopold's motives were purely because of his attraction to Loeb and his desire to please him. On May 21st, 1924, the months of planning were put into effect. They abducted their neighbor, 14-year-old Bobby Franks, while he was walking home from school.
Bobby Franks happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. Leopold and Loeb approached him, offering him a ride home. He denied the offer, but entered the car after being asked about a tennis racket. Bobby took several blows to the head by a chisel, while supposedly being held by Loeb. Leopold drove the rented car to Indiana, where they stripped Bobby naked and covered his body in hydrochloric acid to make identification of his body nearly impossible. They then stuffed the body into a concrete drainage culvert, which was a frequent birdwatching site visited by Leopold. Upon completion of the murder, Leopold and Loeb returned to Loeb's home, where they burned Bobby's clothing.
In that evening, they called Mrs. Franks and told her that her son had been kidnapped and was unharmed, and that a ransom note was to be expected soon. The day after, the Franks family received a letter asking for $10,000 in unmarked bills, and that they should expect further instructions later. They called Mr. Franks and told him to get in the taxi that was going to arrive at his house that would take him to the destination of exchange. Just before he entered the cab, he received a call from the police that notified him that Bobby's body had been identified and that he was pronounced dead. There would have been no trial or arrest had it not been for the rare glasses that were found alongside of Bobby's dead body. They were traced back to Leopold because of an unusual hinge. Only three people living in the city of Chicago had this such prescription, one being Leopold. Another flaw in the crime was that the font type that was on the ransom note was traced back to a typewriter found at Leopold's law school.
Both boys eventually pleaded guilty due to Clarence Darrow's, their defense attorney's, prompting. He knew that the boys were guilty and knew there was no way of getting out of it. By having them plead guilty, the trial would ultimately be changed into a hearing. This meant that only a judge would be deciding the fate of the boys. In this hearing, Clarence knew that he could spare the boys' lives from the death penalty. He built his case around the boys being temporarily insane. He used many testimonies of many psychiatrists and tons of psychiatric evidence.
Nathan Leopold's criminal nature can be discerned in the contours of his face. The slope of his nose and the tilt of his chin indicate his cunning and deceptive nature. Although he blames Richard Loeb for the murder, his profile proves him a compulsive liar.
Clarence Darrow gave a 12-hour speech that arguably could have been the best speech against capital punishment ever given. The Leopold and Loeb case has remained an important strategy of our legal system today. Instead of focusing on the murder that Leopold and Loeb committed, Clarence Darrow turned the case around to focus on the morals of capital punishment. This led to the debate of whether or not the execution of the criminal who did the murdering is justified. He didn't necessarily base his argument on facts, but rather played on people's emotions.
Not merely for these boys, but for all boys, for all the young. I'm pleading not for these two lives, but for life itself. For a time when we can learn to overcome hatred with love. When we can learn that all life is worth saving. And that mercy is the highest attribute of men. us are pleading for the future. In this court of law, I'm pleading for love.
Because Leopold and Loeb pleaded guilty, this became a hearing and only the judge would decide the fate of the boys. It was as if the judge had to choose whether or not to murder these two boys for what they did. One of the sayings that plays a huge role in this case was an eye for an eye. Clarence Darrow used this saying to prove that by killing these two boys for the murder they commit, nothing would be solved. By executing the two boys, they would be doing exactly what the two boys did, committing a murder. Clarence Darrow was the first to introduce the idea that criminals themselves may not hold all the blame for what they did, because he claims that some are just inherited traits. He once quoted,
"Although there were no immediate changes to the laws against capital punishment, Clarence Darrow's defense began the debate over capital punishment, which still continues today. Richard Loeb and Nathan Leopold were both sentenced to 99 years for kidnapping and sentenced for their natural lives for murder. They were housed at the Juliet Penitentiary. This is where Loeb would live out his last days, as he was killed with a razor by another inmate who claimed that Loeb was making sexual advances. Leopold would once again see outside of the prison walls at age 66. He was released after serving a third of his sentence and immediately fled to Puerto Rico to escape publicity. There he mastered 27 languages, wrote a book about the birds in Puerto Rico, and though after claiming in an interview in 1960 that he was still madly in love with Richard Loeb, Leopold got married. Leopold died in 1971 of a heart attack induced by his diabetes. He gave his body to science, and ironically, the day after his death, his corneas were removed. One was given to a man, and the other was given to a woman."